Welcome to Southern Europe, Dan.
Oh, I've never been here before. This is nice.
Yeah, we've got cars.
Okay.
This is Forza Horizon 2. We're here at a car meet.
Are these all your cars?
No, it's like other players are here, but none of these are real people. And I think that might be because the game's not out yet, so it just keeps like loading in fake people to be here to pretend that there are people here, and I don't really know what this is for.
So presumably, once this is out, you would be looking at other people's actual cars.
Yeah, and they would be in here, you know, doing stuff. Instead, it's like it's populating it with people from my friends list, and all these people are level one, signifying that they haven't even played the game yet.
Right.
But you know, we're the day before release here, so you know that's going to happen. I got this Supra, but this isn't. I'm not really looking to drive that. I was in the middle of a championship with different cars here. So this is, you know, it's an open world driving game, just like the previous game was. You know what? I was driving. I got this SUV Lamborghini, which is a ridiculous concept that I don't know
why.
Does
that exist?
I think so.
Huh.
I think that actually exists. Maybe not with the big stripe vinyl thing on
it. Well,
it
could, but that's, if you wanted it to.
Yeah, I mean, you could go get that.
Ooh,
there's this thing, which I drove earlier.
Awesome.
And it was impossible to handle. It's just all over the road. You know, these are just the cars that I own so far after playing it for a chunk of time here. But I was in the middle of driving the Mustang.
Good looking car.
In a championship. So why don't we get back in that?
Are you a cheeseburger eating a cheeseburger?
I believe so.
I don't know how I feel about that.
I mean, it's cannibalism, plain and simple. There's really,
I guess that's just the definition.
No two ways about it.
That's true. Who's got the cool moped?
That's just over there, because this is Southern Europe, where people own things like mopeds.
Just a bunch of hooligans in a
field. Yeah, just people in a field just drinking, being dumb. So, like the previous game, this whole thing is set against a festival. Like,
okay,
there's this big concert happening. And meanwhile, people are out there racing and doing whatever it is people do when they race cars.
Is that based on an actual music and car festival in Europe?
No. The previous game was the Horizon Festival set in Colorado.
Okay.
So it's just their kind of ongoing thing that they made up for this. Remember MotorStorm?
Yeah.
Remember MotorStorm kind of took place at a festival?
Yeah, like out in the like Red Rocks or something.
Yeah,
or
it was
some
weird.
Canyon.
It's weird.
Yeah.
Never really liked MotorStorm, but that's just me.
Yeah, it's not great.
So a lot of people really liked it, but yeah.
People like that trailer a lot.
Yes. Yeah.
So are they going for any kind of accuracy here, or is this just kind of nondescript Europe, or is it particular?
So it is.
Oh, okay.
It's France. It's Nice.
Okay.
Which is how you say nice in France.
I see.
It's San Giovanni in Italy, or Italia,
right,
if you will. I believe these are real places.
How much can you zoom out? Like, I mean,
this is it.
Italy is not shaped like that.
Well, I mean, you know, this is a small section of it. This isn't necessarily...
Okay. On the border, perhaps? We're not seeing the full picture?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, you know, the Mediterranean Sea down here, so you get some seaside stuff. I don't know. I've never been to Southern Europe. I haven't looked at a map in a good long time, so I couldn't tell you about the world accuracy here. But they, you know, they have laid out some roads and gone for this specific flavor. And, yeah, you know, I gotta say, right off the bat, from what I've played so far, and it's been a long time, it's been a couple of years, I remember enjoying the open world of the first game more than this.
How is it structured? I mean, is this all open from the beginning?
It more or less is all open from the beginning. It's structured in a way where it kind of, you start at, I guess it would be, here at the festival kind of headquarters. And then you go out on what's called road trips. So it'll be an event where it's just like, drive here. And you have like 12 minutes or whatever to get here, which is not hard. And then from there, it's like, okay, now get in these four races. And then once you complete that championship series, it says, okay, now we're going over here. And then you'll drive over here. And there'll be four more races. And then, and then eventually it'll take you all the way back to the center here. After about three or four of those.
I mean, is it that linear? Or, I mean, if you wanted to,
You could just drive and do whatever. I mean,
okay.
I could kind of change championships on the fly and do all sorts of stuff. But it is pretty linear in that and unlock stuff along the way. The previous game had events where you were kind of racing against airplanes and stuff like that. That's back. Race against a train, bunch of hot air balloons, that sort of stuff.
Okay.
But we're here. We're in the middle of this championship series. So let's just plot a course. Actually, we'll do it this way.
Any fast travel at all?
Yeah, but it costs money. There are billboards around the world that you have to smash to reduce the cost of fast travel.
Hmm.
They did that previously as well. It works well enough, and you get so much money in this game that you could just kind of fast travel if you want. It's not really that big of a deal.
I will say, if the Burnout games have taught me anything, it's that driving through billboards is pretty fun.
Yeah. Like, well, these aren't like, this isn't like jumping through a big old American billboard. These are little tiny roadside things that you're smashing up. So it's a little less, you know, dynamic than that is. In fact, let's see if we can find one. There's one on the map over here. Let's head over there and just see if we can get a look at it. There are billboards for reducing the cost of fast travel, and then billboards that are just experience points. Here's an XP one.
Oh, so it's just those little dinky things?
Yeah.
Oh, with like Luke Perry on it?
Yeah, that's the British guy that runs this thing.
Okay.
I don't know. Someone wrote me and said that he's on some British TV show and everyone hates him.
Oh, he's an actual dude.
Yeah, and, okay. and that makes them not want to play this game. I don't know one way or the other if that's what that is. And then every time you level up, you get to spin this wheel and get an amount of credits that is obscenely low.
Okay.
And you just feel like, well, why even bother?
But you could technically win a
Sometimes
car
Sometimes you get
right?
a car. I've gotten a car like twice and I'm like level 32. Okay, so. Anna, continue road trip. Anna, continue road trip. Fuck you, come on. Anna. Continue road trip.
Sure it's not Anna? Okay. Oh, okay.
Normally it will take a full sentence like that and not force you to pause and wait for the menu to pop up.
Okay. So when the game is out, presumably there will be other players populating this world?
No.
Oh, no.
It's not meant to be like that kind of seamless online thing.
Oh, okay.
Like you get into an online game like a traditional game. These are, you know, like Brad hasn't played this game, but his guy is still in here driving around. And it's kind of frustrating because sometimes you'll see Brad like pass by again in a different car all of a sudden. You're like, wait a minute.
Okay.
Which is a little strange. When you see level one drivers around, that usually means that they're not real.
Okay.
Or they haven't played the game at all, at least.
Gotcha. I saw a lot of that with the Drivatar stuff when Xbox One launched.
Right.
You know,
exactly.
Like,
yeah.
It's like, well,
same
I know
type
they
deal.
Haven't played this,
yeah.
or they don't own an Xbox One. You have arrived. So, as someone who I'm somewhat familiar with Forza series, I've played bits and pieces of most of them.
Yeah.
But what is the defining thing that makes Horizon not? Is it this open?
It's an open world. It's not based on real world racetracks. And,
okay.
Like it has fun with the cars, whereas like Forza Motorsport is dry and cold by design, you know.
Right.
It's meant to look like a car brochure, and if you get off on that, then there's a lot there to love, obviously. But it's not about like, hey, you're gonna get points for doing sick burnouts.
Okay.
It's not about you're gonna get, you know, points for smashing through shit. You know, this game is a little friendlier on that. This game has off-road racing and stuff like that. You know, you're kind of all over the place, and you know, it's stuff like there are things to find out in the world. So we have these areas here where there's been a rumor that there's a barn with a classic car in it somewhere, and you get the rumor, it shows up as this little circle.
Okay.
So you have to go drive around and look for the barn somewhere in this area. So it's little things like that that kind of blow up the world. They've got these separate little events that put you into a specific car and ask you to complete specific tasks and that sort of stuff. Speed cameras and speed traps and stuff around the world for you to go through. These car meets, which I'm still not sure why those are even there. But you load into those every time you boot the game up, once you've kind of unlocked the first one anyway. We're at the event here, so let's just start our first event.
So, you know, for guys like me that I like racing games,
yeah.
but I'm by no means a big car guy at
mm-hmm.
all, like Horizon would probably
be a better
bet.
It's a way more accessible game, but yet it still maintains like that Forza underpinning, like all the work they do to think about like physics and just the way that cars move, the way that cars upgrade, the way they sound. Like they're able to leverage all that stuff and then have fun with it instead of it just being this kind of dry thing.
This sounds better to me.
It is, yes. For I'm going to say the vast majority of the video gaming audience, this is probably a better choice than the standard Forza.
And not to say, you know, there's an audience, obviously, for the standard Forza.
Definitely. Yeah, people
definitely
love
that.
And this has, you know, it's got your cockpit view if you want that sort of thing. I can't stand it in this game for whatever reason. But in Forza Motorsport, I prefer it.
That doesn't make any damn sense.
It's because like when I'm playing a proper Forza game and worried about, you know, things like not wrecking into other people and you know, maintaining my driving line and stuff, being able to have that cleaner view of the road is way more important.
Okay.
Whereas this, I'm just like, fuck that phone booth.
So is this more how you play, like a Burnout or something like that?
Not quite. You know, the car is still handled with some weight. You do have options as to, you know, what aspects of the simulation you want to tone down. And if you, kind of the easier you make it on yourself, the less money you get for finishing events.
Okay.
So you can go ahead and make it, you know, a much more difficult game and get a bonus to the credits you earn. At the same time, like, credits aren't really that important.
Gotcha.
So you see those numbers up there, top center. That's my skill chain. You know, kind of as I'm smashing through stuff and passing people and, you know, even just racing cleanly. It's not all about, you know, this isn't just like some demolition derby thing.
Yeah.
I'm totaling up these skill points and building a combo. And so as long as I don't get into like a hard accident, and which ends that combo, I will get those skill points, which then, you know, you level up into perk points and stuff like that.
I will say I really like, I can't believe I haven't really seen other racing games that do this, but just a percentage progress bar. You know, usually it's just the 1 out of 3 or whatever. Or
well, so this is, I think Forza has done that previously.
Okay.
It's specifically because this is a point-to-point race.
Gotcha.
Where there's it's not laps. So this some of these tracks will be laps, and it'll just say 1 out of 3 at that point. Even though they could represent that as a percentage. I would actually prefer that they did.
Yeah.
It gives you a better sense of just like, oh shit, I gotta put some stuff together here and catch up.
Yeah. Where did Anna go? She's unavailable.
It's because we're in the middle of an event.
Oh, okay.
She's busy.
Thought she just ditched you.
Yeah. It stands for something. It's like auto navigation something.
Of course, yeah. Seems like the little smoke pillars or whatever are a good way to see where you're going next.
Yeah, it can be tricky in some of the off-road races because, you know, there's less road for you to think about. You know, like it looks a little more open, but at the same time, in their mind, they drew out a very specific course for you to take, and sometimes I found myself separating from that line a little too much, and it making it hard to hit some of those checkpoints.
Okay.
So in the off-road races, I find myself just staring at the map the whole time, which is probably not how they intended for it to be played.
I thought, was it Midnight Club 3 had a really good system as far as, like, they had this huge pillar of light with, like, an arrow pointing down. I always kind of knew where I was going, even though it was an open L.A.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because, an open-world racing game doesn't do that right. You always just wind up taking the wrong turn.
It ruins it. It can be really frustrating.
Yeah.
So I managed to level up again, so let's spin this useless wheel.
I bet you're going to win a car this time. You didn't win a car, you only won 11,000 credits.
Great.
Yeah.
So, if we go into the menus here, maybe we can go to the perks menu. So, every time I fill up that skill meter, I get another perk point. And I have this board here to spend these points on, and one of them is just straight up, you get better prizes with the wheel spin.
All right.
So
seems useful.
But that's 5 points, and it takes kind of a while to get 1 point.
And these are all just like passive perks that are always active?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So I have 2 points to spend now, but I'm kind of interested in having my skill chain last a second longer. So I might just save it up. Well, this is a good 2 point. 10% more XP from the club bonus. Ghosts racing. I don't really care about the multiplayer stuff that much. Oh, well. Let's just hang on to these 2 perk points and wait. One of the other systems in the game is, you know, we haven't seen any of them so far, but there's a photo mode in the game, and eventually they ask you to take a picture of every different car in the world.
What? Like every one of them?
Like Pokemon Snap.
Oh, okay.
I've got 97 so far.
Okay.
I unlocked the perk that puts an icon over the tops of cars that I haven't taken a picture of yet.
That's handy.
Which is vital.
imagine, yeah.
But at the same time, you know, I've taken a lot of pictures of cars, so we're not seeing any of those just yet. Any of these guys with names over their heads, you can go challenge them and just, you know, do a little race like this.
So is that what it's going to be like when it comes out? Is like, because it looks like they're trying to make that look like a gamer tag.
Yeah, but it's they're drivatars. It is a gamer tag. It's a real, you know, person from my friends list or from the world.
Oh.
Like it is based on a real person, but is not actually a real person.
Oh, so is the whole drivatar system in this?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize that. Is there any big changes to that or anything, or is it?
Well, I thought the drivatar system in Forza 5 sucked, and the AI has been a little more interesting to drive against, and not so quick to just bang you around.
Right.
Which has been better than Forza 5.
Okay. It's like driving through cafes. That's a fun thing to do.
Take it, Frenchie.
Yeah.
I'm going to lose this race. That guy went a different way. The driving line steered me wrong. He went a different way and went way faster, unless I pass him right here, right now.
Is that him up there? Okay.
Which I'm not going to make it.
There's no kind of boost or nitrous or anything like that? Okay. It seems weird, because it seems like it has some more arcade-y feel stuff than the Motorsport series, but, like, it doesn't go all out with, you know, boosts and, and jumps and things like that.
Yeah. I mean, you can definitely catch air in spots, but it's not about that.
That doesn't look like the course. Can you go in the water?
No.
Aw.
Well, at least not there. I've yet to find a place where you can get into the water.
Decent amount of licenses, like, for the cars and everything?
Yeah, yeah, they have pretty much the cars you'd expect.
Is there physical damage at all? I'm not seeing any. I mean, well, oh, there we go. Yeah. All right. Yep.
Yeah, you know, you're not destroying the car to the point of not being able to recognize it and all that sort of stuff. But, yeah, you can bang them up.
I mean, wasn't that a thing in, like, early, like, Gran Turismos and stuff, to where the car companies didn't want their cars to
be
seen?
Yeah, exactly. They refused to license the cars in that way.
Right.
So it basically said, like, we don't want you to show these cars in any condition less than perfect. There were other cases where, like, you know, Jeep didn't want their cars to roll ever.
Oh, wow.
Because that would, you know, they didn't want their brand to be seen that way.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's been something that, you know, everyone has very carefully addressed more and more as time goes on. Kind of just gotten to a point where the manufacturers seem a lot more comfortable with it.
It seems like it, yeah. I mean, I can't imagine that's something where, like, costs them more to show damage, right? It's just probably
people getting cooler
with that and be like, all right, well, it's a video game. People understand that. Cars are going to take damage
exactly.
Driving to a wall going 100 miles an hour. It's a good-looking game.
It does look. It's really
tarmac.
Nice.
The reflection looks really nice.
It rains. You know, there's a day-night cycle. There's weather. There's, you know, there's stuff. Oh, geez. I would have liked to have hit that.
Heavens.
That might have been cool. I guess I could actually just rewind.
Keep
my speed.
Okay. What's the penalty for doing that, like, in the middle of a race?
You lose your skill chain.
Oh, okay.
And if you disable it completely, in the race difficulty, you get a large credit bonus for doing so.
Okay. You keeping it on?
Yeah.
It seems like it'd be handy.
Yeah, I just, you know, like, I don't want to repeat races. Like, I just, it's not.
Hey, what'd you get? Oh.
Yeah, anytime you get a significant amount of air, it says, like, hey, check it out, we recorded some crap. Like, great, thanks.
How often have you gone in and watched clips that you've recorded?
I watched it once when Titanfall came out. That was maybe the last time.
Yep, I think I had, like, one in Dead Rising 3 and one in Titanfall. But they recorded, like, a good 40 Peggle 2 clips.
Yeah, oh yeah, Peggle 2 is the fucking worst.
I've got a highlight
I think they
reel.
Patched it to do that less.
Oh, really?
I think. I thought I remembered reading that.
Can you think of a game where you'd want to watch a replay less than fucking Peggle? Like, I get, it's probably going to hit the orange thing and then go into the 100,000,
like,
and great.
The messed up thing is, like, it didn't even capture the whole fucking shot. It was like a bad implementation of it, too.
Yes.
Like, you might want to occasionally, like, if you're just some Peggle weirdo, if you're like a John Drake or something, you might want to watch expert Peggle shots. They didn't even record the full shot. It's just ridiculous.
Well, I know. He runs, like, Twitch streams for Peggle, too.
Yeah, exactly. He's like, pro esports Peggle. Like, it's the whole thing. Anna, continue road trip.
So, is that just putting you back on track for whatever the next area is?
Or,
okay. And what other things can you do with Kinect here?
It's all voice stuff. It's Anna. Anna. Like that.
Okay.
What should I do? What should I do? What should I do? Fuck you.
Does it do the thing where, wasn't this the series where you could go inside the cockpit and turn left and right and it would, like,
track your head? It doesn't have the auto vista stuff. Like, that's...
No, not the, like, car, hey, look at this car thing. Oh. It's like when you're inside and you want to look to the left and see the guy passing you or whatever.
They did do head tracking in the past, yeah. I don't think
that seems really silly.
Yeah. Well, it's a cool idea. You know, it's like a half step towards VR and stuff like that. Like, it's not the worst idea in the world, but the implementation and the Kinect was just not.
Plus, you also just have to look to your left away from the TV if you want to do that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, past Forza games have also supported the ability to hook three 360s together and three monitors to get, like, a full cockpit view, like a panoramic shot of the action.
Man, people that do that are just really into racing games.
Yeah, and it's one of those things where it's like, if you're really into racing games, you're probably playing stuff on the PC, which is better built for that sort of thing anyway, than hooking three consoles together like some kind of weirdo. But at the same time, it's great that they did it.
Yeah.
Because it's fucking nuts. And, you know, like, it's one of those things that we get to benefit from by just virtue of being in an office full of fucking video game hardware. So we can go like, oh, we should do this thing that no one ever does. It was like the PlayStation 1 link cable and
I had that.
Yeah. Like, completely meaningless hardware that no one ever wants to use.
I don't know. I had some pretty good two-player matches of Command & Conquer Red Alert on the PlayStation with the link cable and two TVs.
Yeah, that's...
Jesus Christ. That's why I bought that.
Yeah.
Yeah, again, for people that are into that stuff, like, I'm sure they absolutely love the shit out of, you know, this game or the series allowing you to do stuff like that.
Yeah. It's a cool option, but it's just, you know, it's not realistic for the vast majority of people.
Yeah. Oh, that's just music.
Yeah, you eventually unlock an Italian classical music station.
I think that's probably all I would listen to in this game. That's all I did, like GTA 3, constantly played the classical station.
Yeah.
Just, that was good to murder people too. This is probably good to race too. What was the one you had it on before we started recording?
Horizon Base Arena.
That's right.
I don't think the soundtrack's as good as it was in the previous game. I think they were a little more kind of on the pulse of, you know, or maybe, I don't know, one of us got out of touch. I don't know if it was the game or me.
What was the soundtrack of the first one like?
The same type of just, like, electronic dance music festival.
Okay. You ever been to an electronic dance music festival?
Look at me.
I don't really know what that means.
Look at my face, man. I'm rolling right now.
Would you rather go to one of those or the Gathering of the Juggalos?
I am candy flipping so hard right now. Yeah, I don't know. None of that sounds appealing. I like a fair amount of electronic music. No desire to really go see it performed.
In air quotes.
Yeah, that's not to say that I'm not saying that, you know, there's no skill involved in making dance music. There most certainly is, but that's, you know, I'm happy to listen to it where I am.
Right.
Or while driving, actually. I think it's actually really good driving music.
Okay.
When you were interested in breaking the law and driving too fast. I think it's really good at that. It's really great at that.
Are you like an underground street racer and I didn't know that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. It's all coming together.
But, I mean, you know, if you think about, like, the soundtrack to Wipeout XL...
Oh, yeah.
...created a generation of fans of that type of music.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't know that was so... That was seen as such
a... It had Firestarter from the Prodigy in it before that album was huge, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, and then that album came out, and around these parts, anyway, when we were reviewing Wipeout XL and that sort of stuff, I'm like, fuck, we gotta go get that fucking Prodigy album. There was, like, almost like a staff field trip to go get it.
Really?
Like that, and like Crystal Method did the soundtrack to that Nitrous Oxide game
N2O.
For PS1.
I had that game, yeah. Actually, you know what? I guess that's right, because I hate electronic music, and I played N2O for longer than I should have.
Yeah, exactly.
And I remember being like, okay, I kind of like this Crystal Method stuff. Where I think I bought a Crystal Method album despite not liking electronic music at all.
Well, you know, it was a big shift for, you know, it was a rise of a more aggressive form of the music as opposed to fucking acid house and all this bullshit, just ecstasy bullshit music for assholes. You know, like, late 80s, look at my smiling face t-shirt.
All right.
Like, you know, it was a... And it became way more mainstream at that point. Much to the, like, chagrin, I think, of people that were into electronic music prior to that kind of moment.
Is that what graduated to become fucking dubstep or whatever?
Sure, you could probably draw that line if you wanted to.
So is this all Wipeout's fault?
I'm going to say, in this country, in terms of the popularity of the music in this country, especially with people who play video games, yes.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm going to say enough time has passed that people have found plenty of other ways to get into the music, and, you know, it is quite popular on its own. But in my specific case, and I'm sure I'm willing to bet there are plenty of others out there in the exact same boat, this is all Wipeout XL's fault.
Wow.
Like, I know who Wolfgang Gartner is because Wipeout XL came out and got me into a different type of music than what I was listening to.
Wow, okay.
And I stuck with it to some extent.
All right.
Anna, what should I do? What should I do?
Hey, there's a barn find nearby.
Barn find.
Would you like me to direct you to the area so you can look for it?
Yes.
I think my analog with that is that, you know, I was very strict on, like, I didn't listen to any music made before, like, 1978 for, like, my entire growing up. And then I started playing Tony Hawk. And then it was like, well, shit, Rage Against the Machine and Motorhead are fucking cool.
Yep.
And I got super into Rage Against the Machine and Motorhead directly because of Tony Hawk.
Mm-hmm.
And through that, you know, kind of branched out to, like, you know, just that one game I really liked kind of opened me up to a lot of stuff I wouldn't normally listen to.
Yeah, totally. Sometimes it's just there's catalysts, and I don't think it's necessarily just video games that cause this, but yeah, you know, like, I was pretty against the rise of grunge music,
right,
as at the time I was almost entirely listening to rap.
Okay.
But it was so pervasive, and Nirvana was really good.
Yeah. Yes, they were.
And it got me to a point where, like, by listening to that, eventually I was able to accept that, like, actually, this Pearl Jam album's pretty good.
Hmm. All right.
And kind of, you know, like, it's a very, like, mainstream kind of dumb thing, but, like, that's how it happened for me, to get back into music that had guitars.
Okay.
After years of not being interested.
Really?
Of getting back into music that had guitars.
Okay. How are your feelings about Rob Zombie after Twisted Metal 3? Were you clamoring for him to become a playable character in Twisted Metal 4? Because you got it.
No, I was not.
He had a Dracula car.
No, like, post-White Zombie Rob Zombie is not something I'm interested in unless he's making movies.
Right.
You want to watch House of a Thousand Corpses? Let's do it.
I haven't seen any of his movies.
It's really fucking good.
Really?
Yeah.
He always struck me as a dude I want to hang out with. I don't listen to him.
He's like, the interviews, stuff like that, he seems like a totally
huge movie buff.
Yeah.
Huge, like a lot, I mean, of, like,
seems
old classic
like an,
rock
100%
stuff.
100% all right guy.
Yeah. Him and Kid Rock.
Kid Rock less so. Because Rob Zombie seems like he could have an intelligent conversation about something, whereas Kid Rock just seems like a fucking idiot.
I think Kid Rock seems like a guy who's just got shit figured out. He knows who he is. He knows what he likes.
I'm sure. Like, yes, I absolutely agree. He is, and I understand where you in particular are coming from on this as well. Yes. He seems like he has just found his lane and is like, fuck it, this is what I do.
I remember hearing American Badass because of wrestling getting me into other kinds of music. Actually, a lot of ECW stuff. It's like, oh, this Pantera song's cool. That Rock Band Anthem.
Right, yeah.
But then when Undertaker came back as the biker and he came out to American Badass, I was like, oh, I bet I hate this Kid Rock guy. And I listened to American Badass and he's talking about how much he loves, like, ZZ Top and the Stones and Bob Seger. And I was like, oh, this guy might be kind of cool. And I started learning more about it. Oh, he drinks shitty beer and just likes going around and causing trouble and listening to cool music. Like, I like this guy.
Keep in mind that before, like, those days for him, before Cowboy came out, like, he was rapping with the Insane Clown Posse.
Yeah.
Like, he's not, you know, like, Kid Rock is not cool.
I think Kid Rock of 2014 was pretty
talented.
Cool.
Talented. But
he's charismatic, it seems.
He is performing songs in which he says he likes other songs. That is, like, the lowest form of anything.
But that's the thing, I never said I liked his music necessarily. I said that based on the
you
bands
just like
he
where
said,
he's coming from.
I was like, yeah, I think I want to hang out and have some drinks with this guy and listen to some Skinner.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. He would do that with you.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Then he'd be like, we got some strippers, yeah! And I'm like, oh, Kid Rock, I don't want to have this conversation with you.
I'd have that conversation with Kid Rock. Here's some Pam Anderson stories.
And pour one out for Joe C.
Oh, poor Joe C. Yeah. Didn't he have a different name when he was a rapper? Not Joe C, but Kid Rock. He went by something else, like the Underground Stone Pimp or something?
No, I think that's
just,
you know,
a nickname or something?
Yeah, that's just a nickname. That's like the Texas Rattlesnake.
Or the Bionic Redneck.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So here we're in this spot here, just driving this Mustang around, fucking shit up. All right.
Which is like, cool. this is like if Kid Rock was in Southern Europe to me.
This I is like Kid something. Kid Rock has done this.
Yeah.
This Kid is Rock's a documentary done this. Of the yeah. last time Kid Rock was in Europe.
He got a fucking, he found a Mustang GT somewhere in fucking Southern Europe.
He's got some Milwaukee's best in there.
Yeah. And he's just fucking spinning Brodies looking for a barn.
And I want to be in the passenger seat for that.
Well, you can't, you can't because Uncle Cracker's in there right now.
Damn it, Uncle Cracker. It's always taking that spot.
I know. Because he doesn't have anything else going on.
Oh, Christ, no. What was his song? He had some really popular songs.
Yeah.
It was really bad.
It was really fucking terrible.
Oh, fuck. I'm going to have to look that up.
Is that something I can crash through?
Was it Follow Me?
Maybe. I don't know. I feel like the game can be sometimes inconsistent about which trees you can knock over and which ones you can't.
That's extremely frustrating.
Yeah.
I want games to... Well, basically, I like games where just everything that is not a house that you can just drive fucking straight through and destroy it. Mm. You know? Because I don't like wondering, like, oh, I wonder if this pencil-thin tree is going to go from 100 to 0 if I touch it, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Which happens. There are some trees that look like some trees you should be able to knock the hell over.
Yeah.
And you can't.
I feel GTA has done a pretty good job with that, as big as that game is. It's got a pretty good sense of, like, if you think you can drive through it, like, if that fence looks flimsy enough, you probably can.
You can probably get through.
Yeah. Oh, this is cool. I like this a lot. I really do want to do this.
Yeah, I bet this would be pretty fun.
Yeah. Yes.
Assuming you can get traction at all in a Mustang.
And I don't know how to call 911 in Europe if it all just kind of went to shit.
It's 0800. I don't know. Number phones are weird there.
I don't think my roadside assistance counts over there.
Yeah, your AAA card's not going to get you anywhere.
Ninja Tune Radio.
They're a record label.
Okay.
Yeah, so they've got the same stations and same basic concepts in music that they had before, and you unlock stations that are these like straight up just sponsored stations. Okay. So like, oh, we went and got this record label and they got to play a bunch of their music, and maybe you're into that, but maybe you're not. Sorry.
Well, why aren't you driving straight for those fireworks? Someone's having a good time
that's
over there.
That's the festival like center.
Oh, okay.
Because I'm looking for this barn, but I drove around here through here earlier and didn't find it. So.
Is that like a little farmhouse there?
Yeah, there's something up here.
I mean, do the barns look like, you know, just fucking barns?
Yeah.
All right. So that's not a barn. See that? You should go through
that's
that.
That's
bullshit. Yes. That's chicken wire. You should be able to go straight through that.
Yeah. But maybe it's over here.
I don't know why this looks like so much fun to me right now. Oh!
Fuck it.
Done with that barn?
Yeah. I give up.
Yeah, just visually, this really looks great, I think.
It is a really nice looking game.
I think
so there is online also. We can try to join. It seems like the game got out in Europe.
Okay.
Earlier, because I joined a game and I immediately was greeted by a bunch of people speaking French.
Okay. And so you can just instantly jump into multiplayer. You don't have to. Like,
yeah.
Go
so
to
it's
a
looking.
Spot.
It's looking for a session right now, and it'll kind of get us. So the multiplayer sort of works like Need for Speed Most Wanted did, where it's sort of like you all. And the single player is actually built sort of like this as well, where you sort of just jump. From one event to the next, and well, you drive from one event to the next, one starting point to the next. Okay, so this is going to be a Class B, it looks like. So here are the cars that I already have that are like this, and this one's
that looks good.
The highest stats, so we'll bring this one in.
Man, you bring up Need for Speed, and just their naming conventions, it's just like, oh, every time I hear the title of a Need for Speed, I have to be like, wait, is that the next-gen
one, or the super old one, or the not-so-old one?
Or is that the one with the helicopters or the spike strips, or is that Most Wanted, or is that, like, I just always get those mixed up.
Rivals is the most recent one.
That's right. That's the one I had. That was a good game.
Yeah. They messed up on some pretty key points in that game.
Yeah.
But yes. It was very close to being fantastic.
For like a launch racing game, it was pretty much like that was the one. I was like, all right, they did an okay job with this.
They had the weird tablet app where you could like call in cops on people who were playing the game from your iPad.
That was on the newest one?
Yeah.
Ah, see, I didn't even fuck with that. I tried that for like 2 seconds with Dead Rising 3. Yeah. I like handed my iPad to my sister and I was like, look, you can call in stuff for me or whatever. Like, and she did it for like 5 minutes. She's like, this is not fun for me.
This is completely lame.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And do you race hot air balloons in this game?
You can.
You can?
No, well, there's an event where you drive against a group of hot air balloons.
I mean, they drive
a hot air
balloon.
You do not drive a hot air balloon.
Okay. No. That would probably lose in the race against cars.
Yeah.
Ever been in a hot air balloon?
No.
I don't want to.
Yeah.
Seems really scary.
I think my parents did it once. I know they won a trip in a hot air balloon. I don't know if they ever took it or not. Yeah, okay. They won some kind of contest or something.
Yeah, I don't think I'd do it.
So these road trips are kind of like groups of four events. And the events can be, I guess, random. Sometimes it's like cat and mouse, like try to hit the other guy to knock him around or do whatever. And at the end of every fourth event, you know, it kind of says like who did the best and you get bonuses based on that.
So it's like a Grand Prix Mario Kart type of like point system from race to race?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is legit multiplayer right now.
This is proper online against real human beings.
Okay.
And there's team racing. Here we are, team sprint race, in fact. So we will see if we are red or blue.
Micromania.
You can paint the cars, you know.
Is it pretty, like is the tool
for
that?
Yes, it's the same stuff as they've done before. It's kind of like, I made a really cool Space Invader years and years ago.
Cool. Diablo Swag 33.
Yep. I unplugged the Kinect so we're not like yelling voice chat.
Oh, yeah.
At these people.
Yeah.
It seemed like it was still turned on. So racing against humans, you quickly remember that like racing against humans in driving games sort of sucks because no one drives right. Look at these fucking people banging themselves around.
You don't like the chaotic uncertainty of that?
You know, it ends up leading to situations where, like, people get hit from behind because they're bad drivers, and then they get pushed ahead really far.
Oh, okay.
And that seems like a really fucked thing to have happen. Like, oh, they won the race because they got hit from behind.
Gotcha. Unit Swag 33.
Damn it.
Unit Swag and Diablo Swag.
They must be a clan.
So Turn 10, are they based in Europe?
No. Okay. No, they're based here. This is so Turn 10 works on this stuff, but it's primarily Playground Games.
Okay.
Which is the developer that was started to make Forza Horizon, pretty much.
Okay.
And it's a lot of people with experience in other driving games.
Okay.
Or at least that's when it was founded. Who knows who works there now.
Gotcha.
But it seems like that's what they're known for.
Yeah, I've interviewed Dan from Turn 10.
Yeah, Dan Greenwald.
It took about 20 seconds to be like, well, this guy knows a lot more about cars than I ever will.
Yep.
Yeah.
He does.
He really likes cars.
He really does.
Yeah. I mean, you can tell with that guy how passionate he is about that stuff, and I'm sure that comes through with, like, the motorsport game specifically.
And that's one of the things that I you know, was kind of disappointing to me about the last Forza Motorsport was, like, these guys clearly are passionate about this stuff and get it, but like the game end of it kind of let them down in a lot of ways, and the way they built some of the economy stuff. So this game doesn't have any kind of car tokens or real money transactions to just buy in-game currency.
Okay.
Which is the thing that made Forza, or one of the things that made Forza 5 just seem like a scam.
Okay.
Gotcha. So it's nice that they seem to have learned some things. I think this is a better game than Forza 5. You know, even just, you know, obviously they're for slightly different people.
Yeah.
But, you know, this game, you know, they still have a VIP package. They still have a car pass and DLC cars and all that sort of stuff that, you know, that's kind of how they've always done it. They sell a lot of additional cars for people to care about that sort of thing. But it's less about, like, hey, buy a token to get this, or, you know, the last Forza Horizon actually had, like, hey,
damn it.
God damn it.
That's the most infuriating feeling.
Hey, why don't you buy a better version of the map that shows you where all the unlockables are?
Oh, wow.
Like, what?
Really? No. Jeez. Do you think at this point that do you think the Forza series is more relevant than Gran Turismo? Because Turismo was just the biggest thing in the world for like.
I do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is it because it takes so long in between?
Yeah, I think that is a big part of it. I think that Forza came a long way really fast.
Yeah.
And while you know you had Gran Turismo kind of saying like, oh, this takes so long, and oh, rendering these cars, and you know, oh, we have premium cars and not premium cars and all this other stuff. Like you know, it's been. You know, like. I just think Gran Turismo seems like crazy and archaic.
Yeah.
Compared to this, which, you know, Forza Motorsport is now like a biannual series. They have Horizon here to serve in the off years and keep the name out there. But I think that's come a long way. I think it's really telling that, like, Drive Club is out in a couple weeks, you know, that Sony went ahead and made a game like Drive Club that, you know, on its surface is probably has more in common with Forza than with Gran Turismo.
Yeah.
In terms of just like approachability and the way they're thinking about multiplayer and stuff like that, like that's the sort of stuff that Forza has gotten right for a while. So it's interesting that Sony would even consider or greenlight a brand new driving franchise when they have this one that, you know, was at one point the king of the world, the most important driving game in the world, you know?
Yeah. Well, I don't think Polyphony or Sony did themselves any favors with, like, was it Gran Turismo 5? It was just so goddamn confusing to where, like, early on PS3, you could download, like, a free version of, I want to say, Gran Turismo 5, and then they released the retail prologue, and then, like,
right.
The official I kept thinking, like, when is the, okay, is this the actual
is
next?
A spec, and then when's B spec coming out? It was like, B spec was supposed to be an RPG or something. It's like, what the fuck's going on? Like, yeah, that stuff was confusing, but you know what? The last Gran Turismo let you drive on the fucking moon, so...
It did?
Yeah.
Gran Turismo did?
Yeah. You had to drive a moon rover. You couldn't just drive regular cars, but...
I did not know that. Was that Gran Turismo?
Like, yeah, the secret, like, unlockable thing in that game is driving on the motherfucking moon, so...
That does not sound like Gran Turismo to me. That's... Wow, okay.
Yeah, it was not fun, but it was awesome that they did it.
I like weird shit like that you never expect. I had no idea they did that,
yeah,
though.
Yeah.
Wow. So is 6 out, or is 5 the last one? Or
I think
so
6 was the
now.
Last Gran okay. Turismo. Wasn't that GT6?
I feel
when
like
I say GT6, that sounds like something I've said before. That's all I got.
Those letters and that number.
Yeah, yeah.
Huh.
I don't know.
Well, that's telling, that a thing that used to be like...
Well, yeah, I feel like Forza focused on accessibility and Gran Turismo didn't until Forza came along.
Yeah.
Just kind of how they handled the driving line, kind of how they handled assists and stuff like that. Like, the early Gran Turismo games, I think, are actually fucking terrible.
Oh, really? I loved 3. 3 was the one that I super loved.
Oh, 3, you know, 3 when they had the wheel and that sort of stuff. Like, they hadn't really gone a long way in making it more accessible, but it was still cool.
Yeah.
It kind of almost in spite of itself.
Yeah.
You're a survivor, avoid the infected. Okay.
Oh, weird.
Yeah.
It's got, like, these, like, FPS-type modes in it. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, they have, like, you know, little cat-and-mouse-type modes and stuff like that where, you know, we need to stay in this area, but also...
That's fun.
I need to not... get wrecked into by unit swag.
Oh. I was bummed out when it seemed like there was going to be a resurgence of kind of car combat-y type stuff. Like, was it Full Auto or something that came out in like 06, 07?
Yeah, Full Auto was like a PS3 launch game, wasn't it?
I don't think it was launched.
It was an Xbox. It was the first one was Xbox 360, and then the second one was on both, maybe. That
sounds about right. And yeah, I mean, it was, you know, miniguns on cars and stuff. And
yep.
It was like, oh, please just give me something like Twisted Metal. And it wasn't that great. And then they
No, yeah, like, Full Auto's terrible.
Yeah, it's not
I
good.
I have all 1,000 achievement points in Full Auto. It's terrible. It's a bad game.
How about Split Second? Do you have all 1,000 in that?
I don't. Split Second is a much cooler game.
I actually like that, because that and Blur came out around the same time.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I like Blur a little more. Blur is
just Mario. Mario.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. With like normal looking cars.
Or, you know, Wipeout or something like that, you know?
In Split Second, though, wasn't it, like, super, like, you know, every time you do a race, like, oh, here's the part where the skyscraper falls down.
It's that stuff works once.
Yeah.
Maybe twice, you know?
Yep.
Maybe if I just stay behind him, he'll never be behind me.
That's not a bad idea. So they say in zombies, you just run right behind them. Yeah. Stay close behind them. They can't see behind you.
Oh, now there's two of them, though.
You're not one of them. This is cool. I really like this a lot. This weirdly kind of reminds me of, like, was it Killzone 2 that was trying to do a multiplayer thing to where it was, like, it would change match types and stuff on the fly?
Yeah, that was a really cool concept.
Which never really, like, became a thing anywhere else.
Yeah, no one stole that.
Yeah, I liked it.
Yeah.
Doing pretty good here.
Feeling all right about it.
No. Oh, shit.
Well.
You ever played?
I was second to last, I guess.
Yeah. You ever played Driver San Francisco's Tag Mode? It's a weirdly good local split-screen mode on Driver San Francisco. And I've been wanting to do it for UPF for a while, but the Steam version doesn't have the local co-op, so I need to get a disc in here.
All right. So, yeah, the multiplayer stuff isn't all serious racing. You know, it's got some of this other stuff.
Yeah, I like that. Got some rendered forearm hair.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Trying to think what else there is to show. We'll get out of the online. As soon as it lets me, this game is bad about letting you quit.
Oh yeah.
Okay, so now normally we would drive to the next event, but instead we're gonna go to what is it? Okay, Horizon Solo.
That's what the single player is called.
Quit. There we go. Let's spin the wheel.
All right. Come on, car. Shit. Prize vote, do you have like a doubler?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I'm a VIP, I get double the credits.
Wow. Oh,
yeah.
Sorry, I didn't know I was. Sorry.
Yeah, no. It's, you put your fucking
composing
feet on the floor.
Myself. I'm sorry, sir. Sorry. Like, all right. Yeah. I can go change into a suit or something. If
yeah,
you'd like.
That'd be. All right.
You want any shrimp or anything? We've got it out there.
No.
Okay.
I'm fine. Thank
okay.
you.
All right. Just let me know.
I didn't know this little underground area existed.
Hit that thing.
Oh, wait, there's another billboard in there that I didn't get. Or maybe it's. Nice car, but
it's not eligible for the championship you're currently entering. What game do you think has done the open world racing game best? Paradise has to be a contender, right?
Yeah, of course, yes. What the fuck am I even thinking? Yes, it's Burnout Paradise. The answer to your question is Burnout Paradise.
Okay.
Like, that is the only actual acceptable answer.
I don't want to try to steer you into my specific thing, but I think that's the answer.
Yeah.
I played that again, like, a month ago. It's
fantastic.
It's still really good.
It's a great goddamn game.
Played on PC, still looks good.
Yep.
Still plays good.
Yeah.
It's great. It's got Guns N' Roses in it.
Yep. It's one of the greatest games ever made.
Yeah, I wouldn't doubt that.
Yeah.
I was interviewing Suda51 earlier this year, and I was just asking him about, like, American games and, you know, versus Japanese games and stuff, and just one of the questions was like, oh, you know, what's, like, a Western game that you played the most of? And he was like, oh, Burnout Paradise I played more than any game in the world, and, like, he's like, I've played over, like, 600 hours of Burnout Paradise.
Wow.
Like, all right, Suda. All right, cool. That's awesome.
I mean, I played probably about 200 hours of it.
For a racing game, that is so telling.
Yeah.
Man, that's awesome.
Yeah, 600 hours is pretty fucking
serious.
Yeah, I did not expect
him to
say that. The multiplayer was so good. The co-op challenges and stuff, like, it's just...
Yeah.
Such a collection of great ideas.
I did miss the crash mode from, I think Takedown had a really good crash mode.
Yeah, it did. But, you know, they were doing a different thing.
Wait, in Paradise, couldn't you just, like, hit two trigger buttons and just start flipping?
Showtime mode.
Yeah, that's right.
You just flipped out with crazy slow motion whenever you fucking felt like it. Because fuck it.
I love any game that has anything like that.
Yeah.
Like, when I found out that GTA 5 just had a random ragdoll button, I was like, I'm just going to ragdoll like an idiot over every bridge in front of every car.
Yep.
It was always funny. It's even stupider and funnier with a car. It's like, well, fuck it, I'm just flipping in slow motion.
I need a picture of this car.
Cool. And can you, like, save this? Like, could you have...
I mean, if you...
Make it a desktop wallpaper or something?
Yeah, I mean, I can, you know, I can go in here and change the shutter speed and, you know, do whatever. Whatever that means. Instagram my ass off here.
There we go. That looks bad.
It's fucking intense, man.
Blair Witch shit.
Found footage racing game that I'm working on. Super vignetted.
Oh, all right. I'm listening. This looks like horse shit. Jesus.
And I got $2,000 for taking that picture.
Wow. Gonna make some easy money. Just gonna take some shitty pictures
of cars.
We're
gonna save this one.
Okay.
This is the one I took earlier. That, was it a Lotus? Has an open top, and that's your driver in the game. So I just zoomed in on his dumb fucking face.
Fucking mugshot of a guy who just killed his wife.
I've got to get out of here.
Wait, before he bleached his hair and got on a plane.
Racing filtered. Yeah. All right. That's no. Share that.
I'll download that when I pick this up.
Yeah. Very nice. Yeah. So you know that's largely what the game has to offer. You know, let me look and see if there's anything we're not thinking of here, but. Yeah, you know, good selection of cars, good selection of events. I do think that I preferred the first game.
Okay.
To this one. Just in terms of just like the quality of the open world.
Okay.
I think I prefer the first game. But I haven't gone back and played it, so I could be misremembering. So I kind of need to do that before I write a review of this game. But yeah, I guess my only other advice would be don't marathon through it, because if you're just like going, because it's just like four races, then four more races, then four more races, and four more races, and at some point, oh cool, it saved my settings. Let's take more awesome pictures like this. Art, yeah.
There we go.
And because that was 100,
shit, look at that.
I, you know, got a bonus.
You're a photographer now.
We're not going to save that one though. It's too good. It's too good. Yeah. Some art has to be destroyed.
People say that?
Oh, yeah. Gotta burn all that shit.
My art here is that the back of your car looks like a frowny face with you got the taillights and then you got the little curved thing underneath there.
Yeah.
I like that. The worst filter. Just get his forearm. Every guy looks like. It's like a speed camera. Like. Oh, my God.
Where'd he go?
Is this PT? Jesus.
That counts as a picture of the car.
See that in the brochure for the car.
Yeah. Drive your dream. I don't know. Yeah, it is a lot of fun. But if you find yourself just like marathoning through it, it wears out its welcome a little bit. So I think you're kind of probably better off if you're playing it in short spurts.
Okay.
Because I found myself like on like, man, this just kind of, it, you know, when I was doing like 12 races in one sitting, 15, you know, 18 races in one sitting and stuff, I got to a point where I'm like, you know what, I'm super bored right now. So, okay. You know, either vary it up and don't just do championship after championship, spend some time out here doing this.
I would spend a lot of time doing this if I had this game.
Yeah. Or, you know, leave it and come back to it, you know, play some multiplayer, come back to the championship, you know, whatever you want to do. That would be my advice, is to not just get locked into the championship, but kind of the linear progression aspect of it. Because that stuff, like I said, I got pretty bummed out playing it that way. So don't play it that way.
All right. Go through that fence. All right. That one breaks, but not the chicken wire. All right.
All right. That's it. Thanks, Dan.
Thanks, Jeff.